Thank you. On behalf of the Ontario Transportation Museum, I want to thank you all for being here. Ladies and gentlemen, one of the reasons that we are here, and it's a very important aspect of why we do this, we honor others with our work. As volunteers, it's important that the next generation understands what the previous generation has done for us. Our oldest veterans, and now our youngest veterans. I want to thank you all. The Windsor Regiment Band, Chief Warrant Officer Barnes, thank you very much for coming out here today. This was a wonderful, wonderful day. Please enjoy the show. Thank you very much.
Thank you. coming.
What's our first vehicle here?
Well, Mike, the first two vehicles actually are British Land Rovers.
The first one's driven by Jeff Bottoms, co-founder of the Military Muster. And these are typical troop carriers. They're a multi-purpose vehicle used for radio vans, general. Thus, the right-hand drive. And of course, that's the right side. Or is that the correct side, Mark?
That's the right side.
Roger that. Naturally, these vehicles are four-wheel drive, and they have winches. They go just about anywhere, and they'll climb a tree.
This next one is a red crossing line. Now, he's going to be very much involved in the paddle that will take place, so we need to get him in and out and get ready.
And, of course, it's outfitted with red cross markings, so you never know. And followed by a Dodge Ambulance, World War II Dodge Ambulance, a beautiful vehicle owned by Brian Oliver. The next Jeep, okay, we'll let the first one go by first.
We've got a series of Jeeps now. Mike, what's the difference? I've seen that there's some difference between the World War II era Jeeps.
You got a good eye, Mike. Okay, here we have a World War II Jeep going in front of the helicopter as we speak. And this one, I believe, is a Ford, believe it or not. Ford produced Jeeps with, in conjunction with Willys Overland. And they split it, the contract during the wartime to enable to meet the requirements of the military. With so many Jeeps being produced. Lovely Mary Hawk sitting there. There you go, wave to the crowd, Mary. Okay, and the next one. You speak of it's a looks like a CJ5, of course, and it should. That's what it was derivative of. And it's got a heavier duty suspension and a few other military mods, such as a 24-volt system to drive the radio.
And Mike, you mentioned that Ford Motor Company built many of these Jeeps and Willys. I wonder how many vehicles, what did you guess?
I knew you'd catch me on cell phone. An awful lot for me. Okay, how's that? That's my technical term for today, an awful lot. Okay?
Mike,
is it
1,000
Ford? Yes, it is. It's an M38 Jeep. Probably for military vehicle collectors, the most comfortable Jeep that you can have. And it was, of course, a hybrid from the original Willys from World War II. Yes, these were built in Toledo, Ohio, actually, and used by the Canadian forces, American forces.
Ohio, well done. This next vehicle is always interesting to me. I think the term is a CMP, a wonderful clean vehicle.
Absolutely, it's a Canadian military pattern truck. This one is owned by Albert Bays. He's restored it to a 10 out of 10. It's a Chevrolet. Ford built these as well. They look almost identical, except for the engines. Ford had a flathead V8, and Chevrolet had an inline 6. All the Chevs were produced in Oshawa.
Field Artillery Tractor, a F-18, or a FAT.
Kind of looks like a Beetle. And the reason for that is it's supposed to tow the 25-pounder cannon and the limber. Okay? And the rail for the cannon, a big circular piece that they traverse it on, would lie on the back of the slope of the vehicle. This is a very rare vehicle. It's a Cab 11, a very early vehicle, 1940s. Beautifully restored to 10 out of 10. By Walter Brandt of Petrolia.
Michael, what's this next one? Is that a Dodge derivative? I'm not sure.
Absolutely, it's a Dodge Power Wagon. It's a WC-51. But don't hold my feet to the fire over this one. WC-51 troop carrier. Again, a Dodge Power Wagon for all you Mopar people.
That's a beautiful restoration. What a group. Thanks very much for bringing it out. Fantastic. I see we got two more Jeeps behind them. What era are those? Is that a World War II? Is that a Willys, Michael?
Yeah.
Probably the most recognized vehicle in the world.
An amazing little vehicle. Extraordinary. It all started. General purpose vehicle, Jeep. Thanks very much.
I'm going to guess that it's a Willys. And it's interesting, after the war, there were so many Jeeps that, and no farm vehicles were being produced during World War II. All the production went to war supplies, that they had a farmer's version where they would have plow attachments and harrow attachments and so on. The Willys company, but they tried. And the final one, we got a beautiful M1008. It's a work truck. Linemen, telephone communications, and so on. Beautiful truck. Okay, it's been replaced and is now, it looks like a brand new one, of course, but the folks are no longer use this style. And it's just a wonderful piece.
Thanks, Michael. This last one is near and dear to my heart. You're looking at a GC.
This motorcycle was designed in 1938. It wasn't used in World War II, but it was used by just about every arm of the service, the Navy, the Air Force, the Army, and the Police Department. This one is turned out in the livery of the Windsor Police.
Well done, Tom. How many of those motorcycles were built?
It's a hot August day, 1944. The D-Day landings had taken place a couple of months before, and the Allies and the Germans keep bumping into each other as the Allies advance across France.
The carrier is heading into the field. To the front. Take a sit back and join the front. What's happening now is you'll see the reconnaissance jeep going off to the flank, and the Fox will head over there as well to try and attract the attention of the gun place.
The train gun carrier, the lead guy, has been sacrificed. The enemy's been located, and the battle. Here we go. Stand by.
It's a mortar team, and they'll start throwing mortar bombs at the German position. Also coming in over the field is an anti-tank gun being towed by another carrier, and they'll put the guns through in action. We also have a couple of jeeps, and we have an infantry section coming up, bringing ammunition and so on. And with every advance, you have the people that follow up and do the mop-up, of course, and that's the dirty job, the medics.
How
This same battle took place in Normandy for the both lines running to the field after the Calais gap. You're seeing precisely what your grandfather did back then. That was a 6-pounder Eddie Tank gun. And that was a 3-inch mortar. You can see we've got a 2-inch mortar that we're firing in the field. Will the Allies be successful? That's the question. The advance is relentless. We shall see. Of course, you see the Fox sitting there on the side of the field providing cover and fire. Now they're starting a flanking operation and coming up behind the Fox.
I don't know, but it's scaring the
birds. You see they've got, looks like one of the Americans threw a smoke grenade to try and get some cover, some protection. And here comes the Fox advancing with the infantry behind it taking cover. What they're doing is they're slowly closing in on the position, putting pressure on the German defenses. They're making initial call. Oh, another one went down. Looks like they're in the position. Yes. There's still incoming fire from another position further down the line. When a German position is taken, normally what happens is there'll be a consolidation of that position by the Allies in preparation for automatically to muster and do a counterattack. Okay, we've got a squad of infantry now following up behind the Fox, still being cautious. We've got a mortar team sitting out in the field waiting, again being cautious. And here we've got another recce vehicle now coming in. We got an 81mm mortar that's still active over there in the tree line. Now the other carrier, the mortar carrier, is making a movement. It's still incoming fire coming from another direction. Taking prisoners. All right, They're consolidating, they're getting in ready. And what will happen next, once they've secured the position, the first aid, or the field ambulance, stretcher bearers, okay, and medics will come forward when it's safe. As you see, we've got a knocked out carrier in the middle of the field. Okay, you're going to get a good view of the carrier right now as it drives past you. Again, Ford, built here in Windsor. Okay, with a flathead Ford V8 for all you hot rodders. Yeah, here we go. Give them a clap. That's great, folks. Ford, if you're going to get shot. Now he's laying on his stomach, so maybe it was in the dairy area. Well, it was restored by Bruce Parker, and he's Bruce's driver. He's baby. We won't tell him about the thing in his garage when he tried to drive it out. Hanging by with the carrier. There we go. Good hand. And that's Mr. McKelvey there in the commander's position. And they'll be back in a few minutes to set up for a shot for him.
Some young kid, 18, 19, 20-year-old, 21-year-old young man was behind that weapon and oftentimes dying. So here was a lot of terms of remember.
The shot is real fast. Fire! Fire!